Yeah, actually just started it as you said that.
So Jen's been working in mathematics education, and she may not know this, but she's known around the School of Ed for her wonderful blend of how she works with teachers as well as how she works with learners and does research. So I'm very excited for her to share her current thinking. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jen.
So I am a fifth year doctoral student here, and before I came to Stanford, I was an instructional coach, mostly in mathematics for the last 12 years, and I taught in elementary and middle schools across the country as a classroom teacher. And the research that I do here at Stanford comes out of the things that emerged from my own practice in the classroom and my own practice as a coach. I was driven by an interest in all of the talk that happens in elementary classrooms and how that talk leads to learning and how we learn to navigate all of that talk as classroom teachers. It's complicated, and that responsiveness that we have to have in the moment to what students are doing and how it evolves moment to moment is really demanding work. So I'm really curious about how that unfolds in classrooms and how we learn to do it. It's not intuitive to know how to respond to student thinking in the moment. So I'm going to share with you some research today, but I'm really curious about how to use all of your experience as teachers to think a little bit about responsiveness in all kinds of contexts. So I am an elementary teacher of mathematics, but you may be teachers of other things. And I'm actually curious if everybody could introduce themselves real quick around the room and what role you have right now, and if there is a way in which this topic connects to what you're interested in, I'd be really curious to know. So Linda, would you be kind enough to start us off?
Hey everybody, Linda Ball. I'm currently the director of the National Board Resource Center here at Stanford, supporting teachers through board certification and other leadership and teacher development opportunities. And I'm just thinking that my identity though really is an elementary teacher. That's who I am. And I have to keep reminding myself that I don't have a classroom. So, but I actually feel that this is going to be very helpful in working with adult teachers and helping them think through what is the evidence in their practice and how do they know it's evidence and what's their thinking. So I'm looking forward to it.
I'm Helen Quinn. I'm a retired physicist who's spending my retirement working on science education and working with teachers in various ways across the country. I get invited to come and do workshops with teachers. I've never been a teacher. Actually, I did. I did student teaching in a high school in 1970. That's my experience of teaching at the K-12 level. But I have been a teacher at various levels throughout my career, and education and teaching has always been an interest, so I've chosen to make that my focus rather than to continue doing physics research in my retirement.
I'm Scott McLeod. I'm developing World University in School, which is like MIT OpenCourseWare in 5 languages. We'd like to offer online free degrees, and like Wikipedia in 299 languages. And so MIT OpenCourseWare has a high school and a scholars component. We'd like to create an online high school. And on the wiki side, we would like to aggregate in open subjects such resources as this, but think Google Group Video Hangouts with 2 channels for communication, group text and 10 people in video. And I am listening with all ears about how those 2 channels might, not necessarily for elementary kids, but maybe high school kids, facilitate responding in the moment in new ways.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Deutscher, and I'm in CSUN. I'm a senior researcher here. And I was just interested in this topic. It was very interesting. I was looking forward to hearing your talks.
I'm Julie. I'm from Ben Thomas School. I teach 4th grade. And our school is deeply inquiry-based and emerging curriculum, so doing this is quite, like, every day. I bet every other classroom is, but we really take it to heart, and the skill set of that is really important for us.
I'm Mary Trinkle. I'm also a fourth grade teacher. just down the road at Castaño in East Palo Alto, and I've done some work with Jen in coaching, and so I'm here to see what she's found.
I'm David Oliver. I teach physics, chemistry, and environmental science at Mid Peninsula High School, which is Progressive High School up in Menlo Park. Environmental science kids, particularly because it's so multidisciplinary, we were having some interesting conversations spring up in the classroom. So that's why this kind of caught my eye, because they come up with things that I never considered in many years. Mm-hmm. And make associations that I didn't make.
My name is Ezra Ajaran. I am a research assistant at Istanbul University and also a PhD student. And my current research is based on how teachers using new methods in their classroom, especially in math classes, and how students learning when teachers using that integrated curriculum in their classes. This is why I'm interested in that topic.
I'm Melissa Sheedy. I work here at CSET, and I work in the Hollyhock Fellowship Program, which works with teachers around how to respond to student thinking in the moment through the core practice of facilitating discussion across content areas. And so I'm super interested in Jen's topic, so thanks.
Hi, I'm Kimmy Lang. I'm a first-year PhD student here. Prior to coming here, I was a Japanese teacher in middle school, high school context. So I identify strongly with that teacher role. And I'm interested in this because I want to take this and take away the math and apply the world language and see what happens.
All right, so I want to start by thinking a little bit about what response.
I'm in the eye of the storm here, so. my name is Javier Hines, and I do a lot of different things here at CSET. I haven't been a teacher myself, but I believe in supporting the mission of CSET and supporting teachers, and so being here helps me communicate that to our various audiences. Okay.
So let's talk a little bit about responsiveness. I want to think about this talk kind of in three stages. We're going to do a little work together around a responsiveness, which is why I've post-it notes, and we're going to do some collective brainstorming and thinking a little bit about responsiveness and what it takes. I want to share with you some results from a study that I conducted that is at the heart of the dissertation that I am writing, and some things that I've learned about responsiveness in the context of LM and mathematics classrooms, but I think the lessons are generalizable beyond that, that we could apply them elsewhere. And then I want us to think a little bit about what that might mean. If you were to take away the mathematics and think about it in terms of Japanese or science or any other discipline, like how might the lessons from this study work in the work that you do? Okay. So first, responsiveness has been defined in lots of different ways. There have been lots of studies that include the notion of responsiveness, but they overlap in a few different ways. One is that they foreground the substance of students' ideas rather than evaluate or correct them, right? So what does the student mean, even when it may not be stated in ways that we think of as conventional or using the vocabulary of the discipline, or that may be in some ways circular or confusing, but the student means something, and what is the sense that they mean, and foregrounding that idea rather than critiquing the way that it was presented. Second, it's about recognizing the disciplinary connections within students' ideas. Students may not yet know the import of the thing that they have noticed or pointed out, but you as the teacher may be able to see how that observation is connected to lots of other important ideas in the field. And by making those connections more visible, you elevate the importance of the idea that students have, and you put their idea kind of center stage. And it's also about taking up student ideas and pursuing them in the context of your teaching. So when something emerges around environmental science in the middle and it's not what you expected, it's about looking for how it might be connected to your important goals and then chasing it. How do you take advantage of those opportunities even when they weren't in the plan? Oftentimes they are not in the plan. Students say the most surprising things, and we want to take advantage of the gifts that are in those ideas because they're genuinely what kids are wondering about, what they're thinking, and what they're noticing. So this is how we're thinking about responsiveness, but responsiveness has also been shown to be enormously valuable for student learning. For been shown to enhance conceptual understanding. Where when students are making observations about concepts, those are moments of learning that we can take advantage of and grow when we give them attention. It's been used to promote and student agency and voice, right? When someone's ideas are honored and taken up, their voice is being taken seriously, their ideas are considered worthy, and that has been shown to accumulate into a sense of agency among our students. And finally, it's been shown to promote equitable participation by seeking to understand and include different ideas that students bring with them to the classroom. So, you know, when everyone's ideas are considered and the knowledge bases that they bring into the classroom, which vary greatly, students' experiences outside of the classroom are very widely, but when they bring them into the classroom and that they are honored and everyone is seen as having a contribution, more and more students participate and they participate more equitably. So by taking up student ideas, even when they're not entirely expected and conventional, we can get a number of learning outcomes from responding to student thinking. This is my friend.
Hi, you can begin now.
Faith is second grade. Let's do a quick activity. So what do you think it takes to be responsive? If this is the definition, or the broad space that we're defining as being responsive, right? Taking up student ideas, noticing how they're connected, and honoring the contributions that kids have. What does it take to do that work on your feet, in the moment, when students offer something that wasn't, like this was not part of the plan, right? That it was surprising. What is it that it takes to be responsive? So I'm going to invite you to do a little bit of work at your tables together. I want you to consider what it takes from the teacher. What orientations, what dispositions, what stances, practices, skills, knowledge, or capacities, any of those things, what does a teacher need in order to respond to student thinking on the fly? Okay. So I want you to talk at your tables first about what you think it takes. And think granularly. Each idea that you have at a table that you can agree, like it was gonna need this kind of capacity, or you need this skill, you need this orientation, jot it on a sticky note and accumulate them at your table, and we're gonna pull them all together in just a minute. So let's take a few minutes just to think. What does it take? You can work together, but
I'll be the scribe.
Questioning,
yeah.
Just being comfortable with different, I guess, questions, techniques, is what I would say.
I strongly affirm.
I think you have to be able to elicit and also represent student ideas back to the class. Like, so you have to have a mechanism for being able to hear from students, so that listening, because if you just say, does anyone have any ideas or do you have any questions, often they'll just look at you or like, does that make sense? And they're all going to be like, so eliciting, but then how do you represent that? Like, what you decide to post to the whole class, like which thing you try to take up that you want other kids to build and respond to, because it's an interesting problem.
What I'm finding is you have to set the expectations so that you're going to hear the meeting class with discussion,
so you have to create a classroom culture where the academic discourse is encouraged.
We have to have that content.
It's just as hard in the other content areas, because if you try to put me in an English class, I cannot make the connections that was again.
Other than that, like, for you,
conversation.
Well, the reinvestigation of our students saying matters is irrelevant. Do you want like a belief in all students can learn or should learn? Or,
okay, sorry.
That's
right. Did you jot it down?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I don't want you to lose any ideas. So now I want us to think a little bit about what does it take to learn to do the things that you have on your post-it notes. Every one of your tables has half a dozen post-it notes or more. Some have many more.
Then we just decide it's not possible.
And yet magically it happens in classrooms. It's a tall order. This is hard work. And it's the kind of work that we sort of underestimate. And we oftentimes then attribute to sort of having some sort of natural gift to teach. But of course, there is no teaching gift. It is all hard-earned skill. And so we want to talk about how do we earn that skill? How do we get to that place? So I want you to talk at your tables about your post-it notes. How much support do you think teachers need to learn to do the things that are on each post-it note? Some of them may be the kinds of things that require little support. Others may require a great deal of support. And I want you to sort these ideas across this continuum. So I've put up here, one end is the no support end. If you could imagine an arrow that runs all the way down here to either, it's like intensive or long-term support that it would require to learn to do this particular thing that you have put on a post-it note. So if you could talk about each post-it note at your table in turn, and then come put it up here somewhere between these two poles, and we're gonna take a look and see what we notice about what everybody has written, and also where everybody will put it.
How do you define the support?
Again.
And what do we assume about teacher knowledge, right?
Right.
For
example,
if you assume that they have good subject matter content knowledge, then you won't need support for that piece. But if you don't assume that, then that's another piece that needs support.
That would need to be learned. I mean, I think we need to make some assumptions about teachers, but all kinds of support are necessary in order to go from being someone who has never been in front of a classroom to someone who can do the kind of work that we're talking about. Obviously, like getting subject matter knowledge or content knowledge, which I heard talked about at all of the tables, it requires long-term effort, right?
Yeah.
So whether that effort has happened, say, before you enter teacher education program, whether that effort happens during that time, whether it happens all along a career, I think it's going to happen for a long period of time. Nobody becomes an expert in physics in, a half-hour workshop, right? it's a long-term investment. So rather than thinking about when it happens, let's just think about whenever it happens, how much effort does it take, okay? And that support might come in the form of courses, it might come in the form of collegial support, reading, like all the things that we do to learn can be construed as support, right? Because anything that we do actively to learn is sort of avoiding this myth that it's naturally in us. So talk at your tables about each post-it note, and then once you agree on where it goes, come put it up here somewhere between these two poles.
Just from what she says,
I don't know.
Somebody's very specific to a lot of things that you need to teach.
too, to be like, yeah, because that's learning. I mean, you can always be constantly learning how to work.
Yeah. Sales person. Because something's called sales training.
Yeah.
You listen to what somebody says.
It
makes
it more complex.
Argue for any of those that are over there to all be over here. Yeah. You know, like there's like you can always go like deeper with your learning and like then you know like and benefit more from more intensive and long-term support. Like even something like hear more than the loudest voice in the room, like that could be your life as a teacher, you know, like
and you might learn it really well this year.
Right.
And then next year you have to be learning with a different group of
kids. Yeah. Yeah.
Right, so like there is an argument that like everything is a continual process of learning, right?
But some things I understand why, like you can pick up little things like wait time didn't go all the way, or well maybe they wait time or like paraphrasing sentence starters, those very kind of concrete.
The smaller and more concrete, the more it could move down here.
Yeah.
But then
yeah.
If you want to really use it well,
like. Developmental stages, timeline.
Right, so some of these things, like in their scope, are much larger than others, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, like, having a sense of like developmental stages is something that could take you a career to continue
mm-hmm.
to develop your thinking around. But then, if something like wait time, like habits are wonderful,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, if you get in the habit of like waiting a certain amount of time, right? Like, we all are in some kind of habit of waiting a certain amount of time, and if we just grow that 3 seconds toward five, toward seven, toward eight. Then once you kind of get to that stage, it's easier to maintain that as a practice. So it might be more here on this end of the spectrum, in part because it's a smaller thing to master.
And you can learn some mechanical rules.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Give yourself a clock.
because the seconds tick and I'm looking around the room and tick, tick, you know, right? So you can develop a few kinds of habits that support you with something like waiting that would be much more complex to do with like developing deep content knowledge, right? Like that requires a lot more work. So the scope varies on these. What kinds of things are showing up again and again?
Over on the right, content knowledge is general.
Yep.
Classroom culture shows up. How do you establish the culture in the classroom that makes it safe to be responding to one student? Mm.
So where do you see some things that are about classroom culture?
There were at least two or three over there that talked about classroom culture.
Like for the classroom culture explicitly where academic discourse is welcome and encouraged.
One that's tagged at the bottom instead of the top because it was written
upside
down.
And there's like teacher-student bond, trust, teacher-student relationship, like those are classroom culture.
Personal, affective.
Yeah, there's an affective one up here I remember seeing you all write that.
I mean, cluster that go around developing a culture in your classroom that allows this to happen.
Right. And then I even this like responding without value judgment is another sort of part of that, right? Like the safety that you implied, right?
Both the teacher and the students have to learn to do that.
Right? Right? Because it's not just the teacher voice that matters. Because if you're wonderful and generous, meanwhile someone else is in the corner saying, wrong, you know, like, that's not so helpful for fostering a culture in which someone's going to take the risk, right? So I see active listening, probing without judgment. So there's a couple of spaces where the lack of judgment is seen as a real value, and I think it connects back to this idea of culture, right? What else, what other trends do you notice?
So like the one that's over here, a belief in all students' ability to learn.
Mm-hmm.
So we were talking about like, we can have a belief that all students can learn, and then it's like, how do you deal with that in the moment when you have one student who's struggling and the other rest of the class is starting to wig out because they're ready to move on, and this kid is shutting down, and you know, we've all been there.
Yeah.
So it's that. So I feel like all of these things ultimately end up over there because the belief is beautiful, but what happens is we can lose that. We can that can start to be lost in our struggles.
You get evidence that feels like it's contradictory to the belief.
Because you don't know, you might not know how to make that actually happen, right? So it's
if you don't know that's what you're doing, then you start to interpret it as my belief was inaccurate.
Right.
So what I hear you saying is that there are the beliefs, right?
Yeah.
So those that are held within the teacher, they matter, and yet the teacher has to be able to act on that belief in a way that like makes it come to life in the classroom in some way. And and those two things have to go together, otherwise you end up in a space where maybe the belief gets revised, right? Or I have a belief and I can't act on it, and it's deeply frustrating.
Or you have teachers leave the profession because they believe that all students can learn and this student is not learning, therefore I should not be a teacher.
So this both of these things matter, and the alignment of the two really does matter as well. Okay, so we agree at least that it's complex. We agree that it involves something about belief, about culture, and about content knowledge. And I also see a number of things up here around pedagogy. We talked about some of the smaller ones in like wait time and sentence starters, but there's other things about pedagogy up here. What else did you all talk about around pedagogy, or do you notice up here around the actual things that teachers have to do, right, the actions that they take?
We talked about how you acknowledge ideas. And saying good idea isn't necessarily the way that works, but somehow bringing all of the different ideas that are coming up, giving them acknowledgement. You're not going to have time to pursue them all, so how do you acknowledge the ones that you don't have time to pursue?
Yeah, and how do you decide which ones to pursue, and like how to put those ideas in conversation with one another when they're being contributed? Like, there's a lot of orchestration and decision making in that process.
And the moves, we talked about some of the moves that we've picked up or learned from other colleagues, like, you know, rather than answering the questions or you responding, turning it back to the class and say, what do you all think? And build, how to, which in turn goes to the classroom culture of the teacher not being always the one that has to respond or has all the answers, that kind of thing. That's hard, learned.
Yes. Absolutely. All right, so we've done a little bit of brainstorming, and we have a sense of like the depth of what it takes to do this work. And I want to share with you now the results from a study that I conducted. Okay. So I work in elementary mathematics. And in the context of elementary mathematics, I want you to kind of take this as a case of responding to student thinking. Increasingly, we ask students to engage in learning through collaborative problem solving. And this looks like the teacher providing students with a mathematical problem, but they don't have a procedure for solving, where they say, I want you to figure out how to do this, not just what the answer is, but how would you do this kind of problem? They offer the task to kids, and they give kids a partner or a few partners, and kids are tasked to go off and spend time doing mathematics together, constructing solution pathways, figuring things out, and then they come back as a whole group to discuss it at the end. And the bulk of the mathematics time is spent in this collaborative problem-solving time when the kids are off, right? Well, that doesn't mean the teacher is sitting at their desk returning emails or drinking coffee. Like, what is the teacher doing while kids are in the midst of figuring out, right? This is a very delicate time because kids can struggle. They can struggle in ways that they need support. They can struggle productively in ways that are getting them closer toward a solution. They can encounter all kinds of problems. If you've ever seen six-year-olds try to work together, you know that there's a whole host of things that can happen in the midst of this kind of work. And this is one classroom where I studied what teachers were doing. So I look at conferring, which is the process by which the teacher walks around the classroom while kids are working and talks to them about what they're doing in the moment, right? The teacher can anticipate a number of things that might come up. The teacher probably chose the task for the day with a specific purpose of moving kids forward on some kind of conceptual line of thinking, right? It was chosen intentionally. So because of that, the teacher can anticipate some of the kinds of problems that will come up, some of the struggles students might experience, but never all of them. So these conversations are highly improvisational. The teacher approaches kids and asks a question like, tell me what you're thinking. And that first question has been shown to be relatively easy to learn, right? We can all say it now. Tell me what you're thinking. And then we can say you've all learned how to start conferring. But what happens after that when kids actually respond, when kids say, this is what we're doing, and you have to say something back right now that builds on wherever they are, in whatever stage of problem solving they're in, whatever struggles they're experiencing, and helps them to move forward, this is incredibly difficult work. I'm curious how teachers learn to do this and how they learn to do it in ways that maintain students' authority and their agency. Because the teacher could always say, oh, well, here's what you do, and just tell them what to do next, right? But by doing that, the students lose the authority over the mathematics, and then it becomes the teacher's problem to solve and not the kids. And then now they have an answer, but they haven't really figured anything out. But it's very tempting to tell kids what to do. So how do we strike the balance between not leaving kids kind of adrift in the sea of trying to figure things out, but also not like grabbing the anchor and saying, this is where you should be, and doing the work for them? So I'm curious about these moments and how teachers learn to navigate them. So I crafted a study to answer that question. I was investigating how teachers learn to respond to student thinking in the moment in the context of this particular practice, conferring. These little conversations take only a couple of minutes. So teachers have a lot of them every single day, and there's a lot of potential in them. Because if you talk to kids again and again and again, then you have the chance to develop their thinking bit by bit over time. And you have a sense of how the class is doing and what you might do tomorrow based on all this formative assessment data. So how do we learn to do this work? So the study that I conducted had three participant teachers in the same school serving a predominantly Latinx and Pacific Islander population within a low-income neighborhood in Northern California. I had an early career teacher who taught first grade, a veteran teacher who was moving from transmission-based teaching, which is to say teaching where through telling, to trying to center her practice on student thinking.
By choice.
And a teacher leader. This teacher had been designated within her district as someone to provide building-based support in mathematics. Okay, and she taught fourth grade. So So I deliberately chose teachers at these like very different grade levels and very different stages in their career and their thinking, because I was really curious like whether there was anything in common about how they might be learning to do this practice, how they might be learning to respond to student thinking. Is it the case that these three kinds of teachers learned in very different ways, or did they learn in very similar ways? It's also really important to note that all of the teachers elected to participate in this study, and they all shared the goal of learning to confer with their students and to respond to their students' thinking in the moment. That was their choice and their own goal. I think that that matters, and I don't think that I could make any conclusions about how people would learn if they had been assigned to learn something. So to do this, I embedded coaching in the classroom. I took what's called a communities of practice approach that says that teachers are members of a community of practice, and that they are part of actually two communities that really matter. One, they're part of a professional community where they work with other teachers on their own learning. And they are also part of the classroom community of practice, where they set the culture along with students and they work with their students. Now, the trick here is that we often position teacher learning in one community, the one that happens with teachers, like we all are around this room, right? And we expect that it's gonna change the way they act in the other community, in their classroom community. And oftentimes we bemoan the disconnect between these two. We talked about it in team planning, and then nothing ever changed. We went to that workshop or conference, but nothing ever happened in the classroom. It's because these two things are very separate, oftentimes what happens in one community kind of stays in that community and doesn't always get enacted in the classroom community. So I hypothesized that it would be really useful to put those two communities together. I designed an intervention called Side-by-Side Coaching that embeds someone from this professional community right inside the classroom community, so that the teacher can have professional conversations around practice while teaching their kids, so that the two things are happening simultaneously, that they can be a professional with a colleague having professional conversations around practice and teach their kids at the same time and try out those practices with their children and see what happens, okay? I view teacher learning is there a shift in teachers' practice in their own classroom? Not just like what teachers say about what they learned, but what do they do in the classroom and how does that change? I had a coaching period during this study where that was 2 days a week during two math lessons per week or 4 weeks, so a total of 8 times. I served as the coach and I was in the classroom with teachers 8 times per teacher. Let me tell you what that looked like. So we walked around together, me and the teacher walked around during that collaborative problem solving time when it's time to respond to student thinking. We walked around kind of hip to hip and I would circulate with the teacher and we would talk to their kids. So we would do the practice that we were hoping would grow and try to learn how to respond to students thinking, not in the hypothetical, but in the real, inside their lesson with their kids in that moment. It included things like co-teaching. So the three, me and the teacher and the kids, would just talk together about what was happening. So we might like move kind of fluidly between everybody taking turns, like, well, what were you trying? What were you thinking? And the teacher might say, and why did you do that? And we would all talk together and try to think about how to respond to student thinking together. It also involved sometimes the teacher talking directly with their own students and the coach, me, observing and providing feedback afterward. Sometimes the teacher would say, I want to try it. Let me do it. You watch. Right? So the teacher would lead their own conferring conversation, and I would watch. And then at the end, we would talk a little bit about what happened while we walked to the next group of kids to talk with them. So they were really brief conversations, really short debriefs, but they would happen immediately afterward, not later. It might also include the opposite. They might say, you do what? That did happen quite a bit. Like there are moments where like it's like I just want to watch. Teachers never get the opportunity to watch somebody else interact with their kids, right? Where they don't or they're not responsible for being the one to respond right now. So like the teacher would be hip to hip with me and I'd say okay, and I would leave the conversation, maybe like making eye contact with the teacher. I might like make a comment about it, and then we would talk about what I did after we left that conversation. And it would also include these moments of sort of pausing the teaching to discuss instructional decisions in the moment. So occasionally we'd be like talking to kids, and maybe the teacher would be leading the conversation and get stuck, right? And would look at me with a look that goes something like this. Right? It was like deer in the headlights look, and we'd say like pause. The kids were fantastic at this, by the way. I will say that even first graders think it's fabulous that teachers are learning, mm-hmm. and they can kind of watch it. So I would say, can you guys pause for a second? And we'd step back like this, you know, and we'd say, okay, so what do you notice? Like, what's happening here in this moment? What are you thinking? And the teacher would like say, okay, well, I see this, but I don't know what to do about that. Or like, I have no idea what this kid is doing. Or what should I say? Right? And we would talk about it. And we'd say, you ready? Okay, go. And we'd, you know, step back in and the teacher would go. Right? Or it might be like, I have no idea what this kid is doing. Can you take over? You know? Like, and I'll say, okay, this is what I'm thinking. This is what I'm noticing. Okay, I think maybe we need to ask this. Right? Okay, I'll go do it. So we would step in and out of the conversation, sometimes a couple of times, depending on how challenging it was. Because occasionally she'd say, I think this is happening. I'd say, but I think it might be this. What could we ask to figure it out? And then we'd go, we'd ask the question, we'd find out, and I would go, okay, now we know. Now, like, what do we do? And so we would do this thing where in the moment, when you get stuck, when you're not sure how to respond, you have a colleague there who watched the same thing you did, who saw the same student work, who heard the same interaction, and can provide support. And like there are times where we pull back and you know, the teacher might say to me, I don't know what's happening here. And I'd be like, I don't know either. Like, now we just need to figure out what's the question that's gonna help us to learn more, right? All right, let's find that question and we'll dive back in.
What did kids do when you step back? Did they get back to work or did they watch?
One or the other. I mean, sometimes they would like get back to work, but really they're waiting, they wanna hear. And so sometimes they would just listen. And they would look, you know, and they were just fascinated by the whole thing. And honestly, I think we don't give kids enough credit. And like I said, we had a first grade, second grade, fourth grade teacher. So even the first graders, even 6 year olds, were willing to wait the 60 seconds it might take to have one of these conversations. They weren't very long. Sometimes they were even half that. And it only took a little bit. The truth is that teachers don't have many opportunities to reflect in the moment with a colleague, right? Like to just take the 30-second break to go, I'm thinking this, I'm not sure that, what do you think? Okay, let's go. And just that was a useful thing to be able to provide in the moment. And then we also would have in the moment reflection, like afterward, like as I said, we would walk along afterward and just say, what did you learn? What did you notice? What do you want to do next? Okay, let's go. And we would dive into the next conversation. So we had all like many, many micro conversations that were meant to respond immediately to what was surfacing in the classroom in the moment. Okay, so this is the design. This event, this like side by side walking around the classroom happened for each teacher 8 times over the course of 4 weeks, okay? I also collected video data before that happened. I collected 4 to 6 videos of lessons in the 2 weeks prior to the coaching. There was 4 weeks of coaching. It took a 2 week break to let teachers kind of get back into some semblance of normal without me, and then collected 4 to 5 video records of lessons after the coaching. And the analysis that I did compares the pre and the post. I have all the coaching data, and that's for later, or next year. So I was curious to see like what happened, what grew. So I did a quantitative analysis of this, and I was able to show that like there was significant learning using a measure that I had developed in a previous study. But more than like, did they learn? Yes, like that's not a very exciting finding. It's what did they learn? Like what's actually happening here? What of all of these kinds of things might these teachers have been learning that supported them in being able to respond to student thinking in the moment, okay? But so what I did was, I'll just really carefully show you that I did, I took each of these interactions that teachers had with kids pre and post, and these are interactions that focus on student thinking, right? And I coded them for the presence or absence of what I called a nudge, this moment in which student thinking moves forward. I did a qualitative analysis of looking at the features of these interactions. I wrote memos for every single interaction. There were 105 of them. So I described each one blow by blow what the interaction was like. I have coded those interactions. I wrote memos for trends of those interactions, pre and post for each teacher. And then finally, I compared the pre and the post for each teacher to think about what changed for this teacher. This is what their conferring practice was like pre, this is what it was like post, what's the difference between them? And then I looked across all of the three teachers to see, were they three distinct cases of learning, or was there something in common? And what I was surprised to find, what I didn't anticipate, is there was quite a lot in common. Teachers were in different places, but they moved along some of the same trajectories. So when I examined all of the conferring practice participation, a single overarching theme in teachers' practice emerged. So what did teachers learn? When they were learning to be responsive to student thinking in the moment, they developed and enacted a genuinely curious stance toward student thinking. This was the fundamental shift for all three teachers. Wherever they were, they moved toward a more curious stance. And this is the like internal thing that we're talking about, Linda, but also they learned how to act on that stance. Okay? They shifted in two main categories. They shifted in their identities, this is how I was taking from this communities of practice literature, that their identity shift, who they were, the roles that they played in the classroom changed. Also, the practices they used changed. And up here on the board, I see examples of both of those things that you all identified. So I defined identity as the roles that teachers played in the classroom, how they approached their interactions with students. Practices I saw as like the individual moves they used, the routines, and the skills that they brought to each interaction. Okay, so how did those change? I want to show you there were 8 dimensions of change overall. I want to zoom through some of those, and then I want us to look and see how they line up with what you all were thinking. So first, they focused the purpose of conferring. In the pre-coaching data, interactions served a variety of functions. They sometimes looked like they were about student thinking, but they didn't function to focus on student thinking. By the end, interactions served a single focus. They uncovered and advanced student thinking. They stayed in the moment. This is actually really, really hard. In the pre-coaching data, sometimes they tried to nudge students to do something that was disconnected from their thinking. You could see this where teachers might try to like push the thinking forward with one group of students and it goes really well, and then they go to the next conversation, and no matter what the kids say, they do the same thing. And they go to the next conversation, and no matter what those kids say, they try the same thing. And that effort is like completely disconnected from what it is that the kids were telling them. But in the post-coaching data, they stayed focused on and curious about the ideas that came from their students. They also let go of control. So in the pre-coaching data, there were lots of attempts to control students' bodies, their behaviors, the manipulatives that they were using to solve their mathematical problems, their strategic choices, their next steps, and their turns at talk. Teachers made all kinds of moves to tell kids where to sit, whose turn it was to talk, what you might do next. Stop that, put that down, right? Don't touch that. There were lots and lots of moves to control what kids were doing, right? And by the post-coaching data, that was eliminated as a theme. It still happened occasionally, but it was not a theme in what they were doing. And finally, they learned to exhibit a great deal of patience. Okay, but I didn't see patience up here, except for wait time. But in the pre-coaching data, teachers sent lots of signals of impatience. There was like tapping the table when kids talked. There was scanning the classroom, like so kids might say, what are you thinking? And the kids are answering and I'm, you know, scanning the classroom to watch for behavior. And there was interrupting of when kids would answer back and the teacher would interrupt. There were these like signals that like, we need to keep this moving. But by the post-coaching data, not only did those impatience signals go away, there were all these other signals of patience. Lots of wait time, and there was lots of visual focus, that they looked at the kids as the kids were talking, and they just waited, right? Sometimes they would even say things like, we have time. Like,
just wait.
Okay. So taken together, these four shifts in how teachers participated in conferring represent like a shift in their identity. They were no longer coming into this practice as managers of behavior or as those who like needed to keep things moving, like had their own agenda, but they were patient. They allowed students to make their own choices about the work that they were doing. They stayed with that thinking and they focused on the thinking. The thinking was the reason that they were there in the conversations. And this represented a shift in their enacted identities in the moment, right?
Can you clarify, please, the word confer? I think of conference method, talking around the table, seminar. I think of conferring degrees. I think of communicative process. But I think it's much more specific within the communication language context than it's within identity practice, too, I'm guessing. What's conferring, please?
So in here, I'm thinking about those conversations that they had with these kids with the goal of figuring out where kids were and pushing that thinking forward, right? So just those moments where we would talk to a small group of kids, right? From the moment the teacher would approach the kids to the moment the teacher would leave them to continue work, like we talked about that as a conferring interaction or a conference. So each of those moments, I isolated and looked at how teachers navigated those moments with the hope of being able to push kids' thinking forward. And those they were very, very different pre and post. Joanna?
Oh, I would say just like typically the way that a lot of like teachers think about conferring is like going in, mining for information, just like probing, and then like naming something they're doing and then thinking about how can we like nudge them into something, you know, whether it's like writing or reading or math, just like what can we nudge them, like or coach them into.
What are you doing right now and how do we grow it a little bit right now in these like very brief conversations? So sometimes, like I was saying, the purpose of conferring is this idea. But occasionally, teachers would, and more than occasionally, like they would be pretending as if they're talking about student thinking, but really they're doing other things. And we're going to look at an example of that in a minute. All right, and then I want to look at how this shifts into practice. Because identity matters, right? The fact that you're a person who believes that what students have to say, it matters, just as Linda said, but what you do matters too. So let's look at how practices shifted. So one thing that changed, and I heard some talking about eliciting student thinking at some of the tables. One thing that changed is that all teachers elicited student thinking before. They asked, tell me about what you're doing, or like, what are you thinking right now? How did you solve the problem? They all asked those kinds of questions before. But what I was surprised to find is that they didn't ask very many follow-up questions or press for reasoning very often in the pre-coaching data. So they'd ask those initial kinds of questions, but they didn't follow them, like pursuing those lines of thinking as frequently as they did in the post. In the post, they elicited thinking, they probed for the reasoning, not just what they did, but why kids did it. What drove you to make that decision? And they asked lots of detailed follow-up questions to pursue the ideas that kids were sharing. So they were eliciting, but it became much more robust, and it became much, much deeper practice. They posed open questions. In the pre-coaching data, they used closed questions and open questions, but the open questions were typically the first questions they asked, and after that, they asked more and more closed questions. And sometimes they used those closed questions in a series to funnel kids to a particular response. Mm-hmm. So this kind of funneling has been shown in the literature to be really ineffective, but it's something like, spend 10 minutes in any classroom and you'll hear it happen. Because it's a matter of taking something and trying to funnel kids into saying something that you want them to hear. So in other classrooms, I've heard teachers say things like, how would you solve this problem? What operation would you use? And kids say, addition? And they say, really? And so like, okay, subtraction? What do we do when we want our answer to get bigger? Multiplication? Yes, multiplication. And they ask these kind of questions to get kids to say something, but just because a child says multiplication doesn't mean that they know what to do or why that makes sense, right? So occasionally the teachers would use these single questions, but they would also use them in series to kind of funnel. They'd start with an open question and things would get narrower through the conversation. By the end, open questions predominated. And they used closed questions way more strategically, and I think really effectively. They used questions sometimes to orient themselves to student thinking. So they might ask a question that has like a very limited number of answers, like, did you start here or did you start here? But the answer to that question helps the teacher figure out how to make sense out of the student work, right? So really there are only two answers and it is a closed question, but it helps the teacher to orient to the student's work. Or they might say, I hear you saying that you did this, is that right? Again, that's a closed question, but it's a really sophisticated revoicing move to make sure that you understand what kids are saying to you. So they used closed questions, but they used them really strategically. Also, they did this thing where they used this expanded repertoire of moves for meaning making. And this was pretty powerful. In the pre-coaching moves, they used, the pre-coaching data, they used moves to promote meaning making, but not very often in a way that made them a theme. By the end, teachers used all of these moves to make connections. They made these connections between the manipulatives and the numbers and what this student said and what that student said and what's written on the page and what I heard you say just a moment ago. They might ask questions like, how is this connected to that? I heard you say this, but I heard you say that. How are those related? And they would draw all of these connections orally between the numbers on the page, the manipulative the kids were using, the drawing that they said, with the vocabulary that they used, and they had all these moves for just kind of tying it all together. So rather than them being a bunch of scattered representations, they all had meaning together. They also anchored students to the context of the problems. They made meaning out of the context. And they engaged partners with one another's thinking. So sometimes one partner would talk a lot, and they'd say, oh, what do you think? No. And then what did you hear her say? And what did you hear him say? How are you, what you're saying, how are they alike? What will you do together? Talk to each other. And they would try to orchestrate crosstalk among students rather than just talk to the teacher. So they had all these moves for making meaning out of what kids were sharing. And finally, they closed the conversation purpose. So in the pre-coaching data, there were two ways that teachers ended these conversations. They either just got up and walked away, which happened a lot, or they issued directives. And they said, now what I want you to do is, and they said what the next step was, right? Now what I want you to do is make a graph of the pattern you just told me about, and then they would leave. Or now what I want you to do is talk to your partner about his strategy, and they would leave, right? So they'd issue a directive. But in the post-coaching data, while they did that still sometimes, they also did a couple of other things far more frequently. First, they encouraged students to try their own ideas. So the students probably developed an idea in the conversation. They might say, well, I guess we could do this. And the teacher would say, try that. I'll be back. I want to check it out. Right? So instead of it being the teacher's directive, it was the student's own idea. They also did these things like where they crystallized the mathematical point of the conversation. So one example of that was when the teacher said, so this tool helped you to think in tens and ones. Every time you're using this tool, I want you to think, how does it help me to use tens and ones, right? So they named like a big mathematical idea, or they prompted students to reflect, like, so you tried this two different ways. Which way worked better for you? Why? So that students became metacognitive about their own processes. So taken together, these represent a big shift in the practices, the actual words the teachers spoke, the tools that they were using to help make meaning in the moment out of whatever kids said to them. They got more information and they did more with it by the end of the study. All right, so I want us to look at one example of this. I want us to look at the focusing the purpose of conferring. And I want to show you a before and an after. There's a lot of stuff going on in here, but I want you to see a little bit of this before we end up talking. So, in the focusing the purpose of conferring, teachers and spoken before, they used conferring to uncover and advance student thinking, which is our goal, but they also used it to manage behavior and to hold students accountable for norms in the classroom, particularly norms around productivity. They also used it to promote the completion of tasks. Let's get through this thing. But by the end, they only focused on student thinking. They didn't do any good of this. So I want to show you what that looks like in practice. So this is Carmen. And in her classroom, the students were being asked to work together to make numbers using manipulatives. Okay? Carmen approached a couple of kids who were working together, and Carmen said, All right, Javon, sit over here. I want to see what you guys are up to. And Javon says, we're making a thousand now. Okay, so she's elicited some thinking and he's offered, like, here's what we're doing. Okay, so this conversation can go down the pathway of pursuing his thinking, but instead it goes a different direction. Carmen says, no, you have to finish making this one first. And Javon says, we did. Okay, so now he's starting to protest. Carmen says, in fact, you don't even have a paper. Where's your paper? You need to go get a paper. So Javon leaves the table to retrieve a paper from the counter, and then Carmen says to his partner, Kaden, where's Javon? Okay, now throw away that wrapper, throw that wrapper in the garbage. Quickly, go, Kaden. Okay, so now she sends Kaden off, right? Meanwhile, Javon comes back with the paper, and Carmen says, so what are you guys working on? And Javon says, we did one already. This is the third time he's saying that they've done one, and Carmen says, then show me. So while this interaction like includes some eliciting moves, right? Like show me, what are you guys working on? I want to see what you guys are up to. It doesn't function to focus on the student thinking. It functions to manage behavior. She sends the kids off to go like throw something away, go get the paper. No, you haven't done that. You know, it looks like a conferring interaction in the sense that it includes these eliciting moves, but it is not serving the purpose of moving these kids' thinking forward. Right? So this is how I saw that the purpose was shifting. Okay? So here is a separate interaction. So Carmen approached a boy, Lorenzo, who was sitting by himself. Right? He'd been asked to work on a task taking 35, subtracting 10. Okay? He had this tool, which is called a Rec. It's got 10 rows of 10 beads each in it. And he was using this to help him to do this problem, 35. So this is just a piece of the interaction that I'm going to show you, but I'm hoping that you can see how the purpose that the teacher had for the interaction shifts. So this is the same teacher approximately 6 weeks later. Okay. So Carmen says, how's it going? Lorenzo, how's it going? Do you want to tell me what's going on? Tell me what you're doing. Okay. There is now a 12-second pause. So I'm not going to actually make you sit here for 12 seconds, but 12 seconds is a long time. Okay. And Lorenzo then says, I'm thinking. I can't think. Then 11 more seconds. Okay? I think 35 is 10 and 49, he says. So it's worth noting that this is a really surprising thing for a child to say, right? And it's also worth noting that Carmen has given him the time to even say that thing, right? Especially after I can't think. She still waits. Okay? Carmen doesn't act on those pauses as evidence that he's not doing his work. She doesn't say, no, you're not doing this. She just waits. Then Carmen says, and how did you get that? What strategy did you use? And now we have 6 more seconds. And he says, oh. Now we have 10 more seconds. I think it was the Rec. Yeah, so you wanted to use the Rec. Do you want me to write that for you? Yeah, like to record those words, right? This is a child who receives an accommodation for writing, and Lorenzo nods. Okay. And then Carmen says, yeah, it's kind of hard to go up there. Rec, she says as she writes. Rec, okay? So you use the Rec, and can you show me what your steps were? And then he starts moving the beads and starts telling her what it was that he did. Okay? So in the previous interaction, we have a kid who says, oh, we're making 1,000, right? And Carmen says, no, you're not. and in fact, you don't even have your materials, and now you've got garbage, and you all need to go take care of this. Here we have a child who, quite the opposite, isn't reporting that he's doing any thinking.
I've totally been there.
Okay, it rings very true, right? But in this case, there is evidence here in the long pauses, in the doubt when he actually answers, I think it was the Rec, in the answer that is both incorrect and difficult to interpret, that any one of those signals could have been interpreted as him being off task, as him not working, and in need of like some management of his behavior. But she doesn't do any of that, right? Every time she asks a question, every time she makes a move, it's to focus on his thinking and not the way that he's expressing it and not the pauses or the evidences of him being on task. And as it turns out, they go on and he shows her what he was thinking and he finds his own mistake and he corrects it. Okay? So she's using this interaction to focus on student thinking in contrast to the way that she did the last one. Okay. So while I have another example, we're going to run out of time, so instead of showing that last example, I want you to think a little bit about what of these things on this board it is that teachers in this study learned. And so perhaps you all could just talk a little bit about what connections do you see between the ideas that you all had of what was important and what findings I found in this particular study. I know it's a particular context around elementary mathematics and these kinds of interactions, but what do you see as changing in this study compared to what it is that you all thought was important?
Can you all talk at your tables for just a minute?
We'll go back to that
slide. I will open up.
There's a piece of probing without judgment that didn't exist before.
Focus
a lot on the practice piece.
And like something that was really like a great time for presentation was this idea of the real teacher, like I didn't see, and how like
the teachers are in the
classroom, and like, you know,
their goals. And then
some of the things that you notice that are up here that align in some way with what's up here, and what doesn't, what's different. I'm curious what you all see. I know it's 5:50.
We found that there was active listening that involved probing without judgment.
Like this guy. This, right? So like we saw that in the example with Carmen, right? Like,
yeah.
But there's like not a
there's
not
yellow one too right there.
This one here, yeah, like this was also present, right? I'm just gonna move off a little bit.
And the wait time.
And the wait time, right?
Like there's that was an available wait time. Wow.
It's a lot. 7, 10, 12 seconds is a long time in the classroom.
But it's also a shift in the desire to hear what the students say.
Yeah. Right. I mean,
the teacher in principle wants to hear beforehand, but in practice, thinks the classroom management is more important than hearing. And in the second example, they clearly believe that if they wait long enough, that the student will inform them about what they're thinking.
Yeah.
And is thinking, even if it doesn't look like it.
So there's this like, so my data has to focus on what's in the transcript in the video, right? But I agree with you that these are footprints of something else, right? That like, if I wait long enough, this kid has something to say, right? I know you're thinking something, and I don't know what it is yet, and I'm willing to wait, I'm willing to ask other kinds of questions, I'll scribe for you if that's what it takes, and then I bet we'll figure it out together, right? And it could have been, the response could have been really different, right? And this was a typical change for this particular teacher, to go from very quick, lots of control over, like, go do this, no, managing your behavior, sit down, I'm tapping table, let's go, come on, let's go, to this completely different pace, right? Very calm approach. And Carmen happens to be our teacher who was moving from transmission-based teaching to inquiry-based teaching, so this was a really big shift for her. So,
question, what did you notice in videos in body language?
Body language varies a lot among just human individuals. So two of the teachers always sat for
example, when they talk to kids, like always, just no matter what the interaction was, I had one teacher who sometimes sat and sometimes stood. And what I found, actually, I ran a little statistical analysis of this, that the standing interactions were associated statistically with the interactions that were really about student thinking, right? When I was coming over and saying, like, tell me about what you're doing, there was an accusation of that, like, I know it's not much. Okay? Like, I challenge you, but when that teacher sat, she was more likely to be focused on student thinking and nudge it forward, both pre and post, right? So body language changed, like, but it varied a lot by teacher based on what their habits were. Like tapping was one teacher's habit, and that like diminished. The standing was something that shifted. It was very teacher by teacher, even though body language overall was different. And I think that the like sitting thing and just like kind of committing to the conversation was something that was really important.
I'm curious as to the impact throughout the rest of the day, because it seems like the couple of things. I'm really struck by I forget the boy's name or the student's name she waited so long for.
Yeah.
How I bet you that's either a coping mechanism. If I wait long enough, the teacher will leave. Mm-hmm. Or it's how many people listen to this person?
Yeah.
So this must have been a game changer. And so I'm just wondering, what do these teachers feel like behavior issues overall? What happens to behavior issues in a classroom when the teacher makes such a profound shift to respect?
And is there more listening in the other container?
And is there more? I mean, how could you be this amazing in math and then switch go back to, I don't really want to know what you're thinking in writing?
Yeah.
So did that transfer?
So actually, in this particular case, and honestly, as a teacher and a coach of elementary mathematics, this is more typical that this teacher was actually a really sophisticated pedagogue in literacy and had spent years learning how to teach reading and writing in a really inquiry-based, student-centered approach, and then became deeply dissatisfied with what math was looking like because the disconnect became more and more profound over the years. And I happened on the scene at that moment when the dissatisfaction was really high. Like, this no longer makes sense to me that I'm doing this from 9 till 11 in the morning, and then at 11 I teach like this, right? I don't want it to be like that. I hate it. You know, like, I don't like the way it feels. I love the way it feels when I teach books. I love the way it feels to teach writing. And I just, like, it feels so yucky to do math. Can you make this feel better? And honestly, this is the entry point for professional development around elementary mathematics. Usually teachers feel more comfortable with their practice in literacy and feel then more committed to growing it because it feels like a wonderful place to do that work. And then as they become more and more developed in literacy, my experience is that dissonance between the other parts of the day becomes profound, and there's an entry point to moving on math. That has been, like, over the last 12 years, what I have seen is like, oh, math doesn't feel that way, you know, like, maybe we can do something about that. So she's actually an excellent example of that. She was actually teed up. She had tons of tools from literacy,
right?
That what you're seeing is like the floodgates opened and she started to apply them in mathematics.
Yeah.
So like I didn't study her whole day for any of the teachers, but that is a pathway that I think is one worth examining, and for us all to be thinking about how teachers often have very siloed practices, even when they're generalists in elementary classrooms. They may behave differently at 9 o'clock and at 10 o'clock and 11 o'clock. And if we can figure out how to leverage skill from one part of the day and apply it across the day, we can get some power. Because you can see, like, 8 times I was in the classroom, right? It was a big shift in just 8 times, right? So this was intensive, but I wouldn't call it long-term support,
right?
8 times, that's it.
Right? But just to be devil's advocate, you don't know this.
No, it's a good point, right? Like, what is sustained and what expires, right? Are there? I mean, this is the kind of thing that would be really interesting to follow up with the same teachers. Yep.
Yeah.
All right. So one question I have for you before we wrap up is, part of this shift is the product of the kind of intervention that we use. By putting a coach right in there in the moment when the decisions are hard, right? If we want to respond to student thinking in the moment, you need support in the moment. That's my claim. So I'm curious, in the kind of work that you do, either as a teacher, where you're learning to respond to student thinking and encounter problems, or as someone who works with teachers or is thinking about learning to respond, how do you support others in learning to respond? How would this model of supporting teachers directly in the classroom get applied in the work that you do? What might that look like? This is what it looked like because of what I was doing, and I'm curious how that might apply to your own work. So I'm wondering if you can just take 2 minutes and talk at your tables a little bit about what this kind of like embedded support could look like in other contexts.
I think it'd be great, particularly, you know, I was just thinking when we talked about how jarring it is, like,
Well, and I also think there's this piece of like intensive support obviously is going to show huge growth,
right?
But then there's this piece of like when you have a new class, things change drastically. So then your practice has to change, right? So if you don't have that consistent support, then implementing it again and again and again,
you're asking questions about like how sustainable is that, or
how can we give teachers that kind of coaching with somebody who's some step along the line, not necessarily a single coach that comes in and coaches all of them.
I can imagine a peer model.
What's gaining in popularity with national board work is not so much developing site-based cohorts that do this peer support with each other. And maybe they collectively work on one aspect of the certification process, but they're not pursuing certification necessarily.
But do they have time to be in one another's classroom?
Well, that's the thing, is that the site-based develops resources. I'm just struck by that they don't have like a gen going there side by side, but they have each other.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that high level, like a purpose that is high level, like developing your ability to respond in the moment, with resources and time to collaborate and to keep learning together, they say, over through a whole year, might be a scalable way.
Yeah, it's not clear.
clear from these findings, like how much of this one could get simply by having a reflective partner as opposed to somebody who has that expertise. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we would simply say, there was one teacher who, like, what she wanted most of all was to come up to me and say, okay, here's what I'm seeing, here's what I'm thinking of doing, is that right? And I would go, yes, you know, like, yeah, sounds good. And then she would go do, but needed the time to kind of process out loud. And it just requires a partner for that when right. teachers are so isolated. So we might even be able to start thinking of, like, how much of these kinds of gains could we get by having long-term partners? Somebody who, my kids go to PE at 10 a.m., mm-hmm. yours go at 11. What if I spent 15 minutes in your room exactly. while my kids are away, and you come over and spend 15 minutes when my kids are away, and we kind of swap rooms like that just to be co-present in the classroom? At one point I asked the teacher, what did you notice? And she said, nobody's ever asked me that question. Mm. So I feel that's not a hard question to ask, but if we can position people so that there's more opportunity to be co-present in classrooms, we might be able to get quite a lot of these things. Mm. All right, thank you all for your time tonight.
I tried to find your Twitter
Yeah.